Put down your bagel. It's time to talk news. What's going on, guys? It is the Sunday edition of Mailbag. It's where we just take the questions you guys have written in here at collidervideo@gmail.com, and we just go over it. It's a bunch of people here that just love movies just like you guys do. We're going to kick back, relax, and talk about these things, and enjoying my conversation that I like to have with myself, as I don't know what the hell I'm talking about right now. Doesn't matter, because it's Sunday. Enjoy your eggs. Moving over is Mark Riley. What's up, buddy? How you feeling?
Hey, I'm feeling okay.
Good.
I'm feeling okay. I'm glad to be here on this fine Sunday.
Sitting next to you is Sinead DeVries. Hello, Sinead.
Good morning, everybody. Happy to be here.
Oh, thank you very much. All right, let's get right into it, because Sinead obviously doesn't want to talk to us.
All right. Bruce Rains writes, "Hey, Collider, with the recent talk of Bruce Willis mailing it in lately and not preparing for roles, other than Die Hard, what do you feel is his best performance of his heyday? I loved his performance in The Jackal as the villain. After being so used to seeing him as the hero, it was so cool to see a different performance, which I think goes down as one of the great villain performances by an actor, especially an actor not known for playing the bad guy. Thoughts? Awesome show and keep up the great work."
I thought it was awesome also.
Awesome.
That was awesome.
You knew I was going to let you get away with that. Now, I think that he's got a couple. There are very few times now where you can watch a Bruce Willis movie and he's not playing Bruce Willis getting a paycheck. But he has actually shown up to work recently, and that's with Looper. I think he was great in Looper. I think that he played the part almost, it was kind of very similar to what he did in 12 Monkeys. I felt those two roles were very similar, that he was able to kind of tap into this damaged, sad. I mean, he was really good in Looper. He was really good in Looper. Riley?
Yeah.
Don't you think?
Yeah. He was great. No, he's great performance in Looper. And you thought I wasn't paying attention.
And then we have Pulp Fiction, and then Unbreakable, where the other, those are four of them that I think. 12 Monkeys, Looper, Pulp Fiction, and Unbreakable were the four movies that I think you can get solid, solid performances out of Bruce Willis where he's not playing John McClane.
Yeah, I was going, Unbreakable is actually my favorite performance of his. It's so understated. It's very quiet. He was like the opposite of John McClane in Unbreakable. He doesn't want this power. He doesn't want to do any of that. He just wants to go about his life, and then ultimately he has to do the right thing. So I like that. You said all the good ones. Pulp Fiction is up there. Looper is great. I'm trying to think of some other non-Bruce Willis or Die Hard ones, but I think you nailed them. So,
Sinead, you got any?
Well, I love Die Hard, and I actually haven't seen Looper, but I would say...
Wow.
No, I haven't seen it, but I would say Pulp Fiction.
Mm-hmm.
And like growing up, I really loved the Fifth Element. And
oh, that's a good one.
Yeah, I loved that movie. And also, I think he's not, I don't think he's even close to being mediocre or bad at all in The Sixth Sense.
Yeah.
I think he's great,
he's great
in that movie as well.
There are times, like he was tuned in. He was locked in. Shyamalan got some good performances out of him for two movies, and, mm-hmm. and you know, Tarantino got a great performance out of him. I'm wondering who else can do that, or if he's able to do that anymore. I mean, certainly Rian Johnson did it not too long ago, mm-hmm. so I hope to see that back from him. We'll see. All right, what's next?
Louis Lopez writes, "Hey, Collider crew, love the show and enjoy all of you discuss your thoughts and opinions on all things movies. My question involves movies we know are the worst. For the most part, I've avoided worst movies with a passion. But lately, after a question on Mailbag involving whether worst movies should be seen or avoided, I've been making an effort to see them a bit more, to see how bad they really are and to wonder how they could have been fixed, if at all. From yesteryear, hits like Fantastic Four, to Terminator, Genesis, to strolling down memory lane of 2002 with Rollerball and Swim Fan. Which got me thinking, are there any worse movies that you still watch to kind of study from and wonder how you would improve upon it, and what are the kinds of important lessons of filmmaking that you've learned from watching worse movies?"
Nice. You know what it is? It goes back to what you were saying earlier on. I think that a lot of times I'll watch movies that I knew there was something in there. I just wonder, like, you know, and I've been saying this, talking about this franchise, so I'm blue in the face here, and you're probably getting sick of it, and I apologize, but Masters of the Universe, even watching that Dolph Lundgren one where they're in Eternia for like 15 minutes of the whole entire movie.
Yeah.
And it's like, that alone, never go to Earth, never do this. And you start to, you use your imagination more because of like, and not, and you don't know exactly if the version, if you had all, if you had money and you had, all, had the will to be able to make all these things, you had the studio contacts to be able to make it, you don't know if your version would turn out any better than the ones that came out. You just hope that it would, and you hope that, that your fan ideas are kind of going to work out. And that would be one of them. But I think that The Last Airbender is one that I wasn't very familiar with the property, but I heard all the passion from everybody that was familiar with the Nickelodeon cartoon and loved everything that happened with it. And watching it, I remember saying, there are some really cool elements here, no pun intended, that things that could happen in this movie that could really work and carry on a franchise, but it was just done so piss poorly. So I think for me, it's just things of what could have worked better, or what I would have liked to have seen. Or I do that often with bad movies.
Yeah, I like to watch these movies, and they said it in the question, you learn from them.
Right.
And especially I think if you're in the industry or you want to be maybe a writer, a director, even an actor, it's important to watch everything. So
yep.
Bad movies included. And I especially go after movies even when, like Terminator Genesis, he brought it up here. I missed it in the theaters. Everybody was like, oh my God, this is awful. I went and watched it and I kind of was like, why? So let me look at this. And you know, I made up my own decision, but I like kind of breaking it down as a film lover. Why didn't this work? Is it the script? Is it this? So if you're a lover of film, I highly recommend seeing everything. Or if you're like my mom, who has no idea about film, she just goes and watches everything and doesn't know why
What have you seen recently, Mrs. Riley?
Well, I'm gonna go see that movie about the singing dogs.
Oh, really? You want to see Sing? That's what it's called.
No. It's about the secrets that they do in their life, and they sing too.
Oh, Mrs. Riley, no, that's not a singing movie. That just has songs by different artists.
But there's a song, and they're dancing.
Oh, you know what? I'll give it to you. All right, what's next?
All right, Robert Johnson writes, I know part of your job is to watch all types of movies, but let's pretend it wasn't for a second. Yeah. Would you still watch movies that look terrible only because you're a fan of a franchise actor or director? I'm struggling with the decision to watch Ghostbusters or not.
Yes, I would, and I did. If there are movies that I thought were going to be, that looked terrible to me, but like you said, I was a fan of a particular actor or a premise or that something that I had hope for me personally, I would go and see those movies. I did that before I was doing this job. I would say, okay, I don't think this is going to be very good, but I'm going to take a shot because I love movies. I like to watch movies. And going back to the previous question, I like to think, even though it didn't work out the way I wished it would have, could they have done this, that, and that? And I start to just use my brain a little bit more for creativity purposes. But, if you want to see Ghostbusters and there's something in your brain that makes you want to see Ghostbusters, don't worry about what everyone else is saying. If you want to go see it, go see it. If it's something in your brain, you like the franchise and you hope that it's going to be good, go see it. I know a lot of people that have the hope that Ghostbusters is going to be good, but they don't have hope in what they've seen in the trailers, but they're going to see it. Roka said it this past week on Movie Talk. Yes, I wouldn't listen to comments or worries if you want to see it. But if you looked and you go, doesn't interest anymore, I'm done, I don't care about this movie, that's another conversation you should have inside of your head in front of a mirror. That's what I do. Don't judge me. Riley?
Yeah, I think it's... If you want to see it, go see it. Don't, I mean, the moral of this story is don't listen to anybody. It's all about you. If you want to see this movie, see this movie. Perfect example for me was I heard all you guys got to see Batman v Superman before.
Right.
And everybody had their opinion, and they're pretty strong opinions about
yeah.
the movie wasn't good. Man, I was even spoiled. They're like, yep, this is what's happening because I'm producing some of the shows. So I have to hear all these people talk about it. And I'm like, you know what, though? Superman's my boy. I'm going to go see this movie. Right. I got to see this movie. And I tell you, it kind of worked on the opposite. I heard so much negativity that I walked in expecting something worse. And I had a hell of a good time. I like Batman v Superman a lot.
Right.
So I'm glad I did. See, you never know. If you listen to people, you might go in. It might color your opinion before you even know what your opinion is.
I think this really kind of relates to Sinead because you don't necessarily have to see all these movies at all. Because like lots of, you don't have to. You're not doing reviews. I mean, you want to be up on them because you're a movie fan. But do you go and see if you see something that you maybe are interested in as an actor or director, but you think it might be bad? Do you go and see it?
Yeah, I mean, I think the keyword in this question is like struggling. If you're struggling and you really can't come to a conclusion, then go see it. But like you said, if you don't care, if you look at it and you're like, I don't care about this at all, then no. But if there's something in me that's like, I'm still a little interested, then I'll see. And we had talked about this all the time, but like the Vacation reboot, Dennis and I really like the Vacation reboot, and you guys pooped all over it, which is totally fine because it's super like stupid humor, but I enjoy watching it. I've seen it multiple times. So, wow. I mean, yeah, there are some movies that you could even go and see a movie like that was pretty bad. It's not the best film out there, but I still enjoy it. So if there's something that's speaking to you to go see it, then yeah, I would see it.
I respect your opinion on Vacation, but I'm going to have to ask you to leave.
What's next? It's funny. It's funny, you guys. All right. Kevin Stevens writes, "Hey, guys. A few weeks ago when I saw X-Men Apocalypse, it wasn't playing in IMAX anywhere. After The Dark Knight, I tried to see everything in IMAX. It prompted me to get a nice sound system for my own home. When I saw X-Men, I just kept thinking how the sound should have been better. Most people don't think about sound being a big part of your movie experience. I won't buy BVS on VOD right now because I still think digital movie technology isn't anywhere near the sound quality on Blu-ray. Do you guys think sound is very important to a movie and maybe even hurt X-Men? And do you think people's opinions on movies in general are more negative because of lower quality sound on digital? Stay sweaty, shit rats."
Sound absolutely it's beyond important. And yes, I didn't notice the X-Men sound, but clearly you did. So that's something that good on you, first of all, because I think that's why I always when I'm seeing movies like that, I got to see them in the theater just the sound, the way that it just hits you, you're engulfed in it. Mm-hmm. And I think a movie, whether it be X-Men or Star Wars or, you know, the Avengers, or even certain movies like The Revenant, you know, a movie like that, to where you can just hear birds chirping, you hear the wind, you feel like you're with Leonardo DiCaprio in the damn woods. When it's very important. I remember seeing one of the things when I got my first surround sound kind of all set up in my place years ago, the movie that I went out and bought, I hate this movie, it was Pearl Harbor. I went out and I bought
you hate Pearl Harbor?
It's ridiculously dumb.
Okay.
Because I hate that movie because, I'm going to get sidetracked, because it was sold on the events of what happened at Pearl Harbor.
Right.
And then it
totally
became
like
a love story. And yeah. It's like,
that is fair.
Sure.
It's another video. But I went out and bought it because the sound in that movie is insane.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And you could hear the planes kind of coming through on the sides. And that was just I don't remember how it was in the theater, because I remember just being disappointed with the movie. But then when I was paying attention to the sound, there are certain movies that are just elevated by sound design. And it's absolutely important. It's a great question. Riley, how do you feel about it?
Yeah, it is vital.
Yeah.
The sound is vital. I remember seeing a short and the sound wasn't, and it wasn't that good, and man, it took away from the experience.
Yeah.
I couldn't judge it properly because there was issues with the sound. In making the movie, the independent movie that I made, man, that was so tough finding a good sound mixer and a sound editor, and it was so important. It was a horror movie, so we had to really come up with things that were off camera, so we had to come up with a nice sound that might, you know, add to the story. That's what it does. It adds to the story. Turn on Jaws for the first, I don't know, minute, and you're underwater and you're hearing these sounds of like whales and the ocean before the music kicks in. Man, that is some scary stuff right there that Spielberg's doing before even the music comes
in.
So, and you brought up Pearl Harbor, great example, because you hear those things. There's a reason why there are two Oscars given for sound alone, sound editing and sound mixing.
Right.
It's so vital, man. If you just turn off, I would say it's even more important sometimes, depending on the storytelling, than special effects, you know, because you could actually, again, look at Jaws. Shark wasn't working, so you're gonna have to rely on other things. He relied on cameras and sound, and it's such a great thing. So, good question, because the X-Men stuff, I still haven't seen it. Can you believe it?
Oh, wow.
Yeah, this is one of those, it goes back to maybe another question, where I've heard so many things.
I liked
like,
it.
Yeah, I know you did. I gotta see it, but yeah, good question.
I have a question.
Sure.
What's next?
Okay.
Pamela Williams writes, "Hey guys, since you've done an excellent job explaining Rotten Tomatoes in the past, I was wondering if you could explain another movie-related site, Box Office Mojo. It seems that the box office numbers for Saturday are never released until Sunday, which made sense to me until I started to realize that the Sunday numbers are usually released early to midday Sunday here in New York. How do they calculate those numbers before the day is over? Is it an actual number or more of a projection of what the movie will probably make based off of pre-booked tickets? Thank you."
I think that it's exactly that. I mean, Riley's going to answer better than I can, but that's why you always get the actual numbers on Monday. They give you the projected numbers on Sunday because, like you said, with the tickets and everything that they're kind of calculating, that they have a pretty good idea, and they're pretty accurate for the most part. They're off by a little, but for the most part, the numbers come in on Monday. That's the actual numbers. That's why you always see that. That's why a lot of shows sometimes will wait to do their reports until Monday, and then other times there are these Sunday reports that they follow Box Office Mojo because they're so close to being accurate every time. But that's the way I read it.
Yeah, no, you're right on, dude. And I mean, Batman v Superman, I believe, came out and was projected higher, and then they had to change. You see it all the time. Monday comes around, they're like, sorry, actually it made this.
Right.
Because the hard numbers come in. And that leads up, leading into the weekend, they already have a pretty good idea. They're doing the tracking. So they're doing, man, it's pretty severe what they do. All these numbers that they get all this data and they're putting it in there. Then they're getting the box office receipts. We were talking to the Hayes brothers for Conjuring 2,
right.
And they were talking about how they had no idea the Conjuring was going to do the numbers they did. And those guys got the call on Saturday night. We're breaking the box office records right now. We just got the numbers in. Come on out for a party. You know, they learned that on Saturday night. It happens all through the weekend. Monday, the hard numbers come in. Box Office Mojo is just a great aggregator of all these numbers, and so you should trust them implicitly for that.
All right, what's next?
Philip writes, hey guys, my wife, who is a speech instructor, brought up a great point about the BFG failing might be due to groupthink, where people discuss ideas in a room and they all agree to something, and no one speaks up to say if it's a bad idea or to question it. Look, Steven Spielberg is great, and I'm not trying to bash him. However, the BFG is a flop, and I wonder if too many people were afraid to challenge Spielberg's direction or ideas. Was this a situation that the name recognition or experience of Spielberg kept Disney from questioning him on this project? Great show, Phil.
That's a fantastic question, Phil. Yeah. It really is, because, you know, you don't want to think that Steven Spielberg is a guy that just doesn't listen to anyone. I don't believe that he is, but you also have to be realistic to where when you get to a level of a Steven Spielberg, it is hard to find people that you work with that aren't yes men and don't look at you as this like godlike figure. And that's, I think, a lot of times why you hire someone like a Kathleen Kennedy, who someone will challenge your ideas. And she's obviously not with Steven Spielberg anymore, but I mean, I think that Steven Spielberg will pitch ideas to certain friends. I think he'll talk to certain people. That's what they do. And even reading certain books of these guys over their careers, I mean, you listen to what George Lucas did originally with the original Star Wars and how he pitched everything to Francis Ford Coppola and Steven Spielberg and Brian De Palma. And they have this circle of friends. Now, I don't know if they necessarily still do that, but you're going to have people that it's going to be hard. Let's say you're a new, 28-year-old, 30-year-old kid that's hired by Spielberg. Are you the type of person that you're hired for the fact that you'll tell Steven Spielberg, well, Steven, I think that maybe you should do this, or you're afraid he goes, don't call me Steven, you're fired. Or if there's, you know, maybe you're just a guy that says, oh no, it's a great idea. It could be real. It's Steven Spielberg. I got to trust him. You get inside your own head. So who the hell knows? But the marketing was weird in this movie. The CGI, I think, looked a little strange from what I saw in the trailers. That's one I missed and I want to go back and see. It also it's a kids movie for the most part, and you got Secret Life of Pets, you have Dory. It was a bad time for the movie to come out. People really didn't know what the hell it was. If you were a fan of the book, then I think that maybe you went and saw it, but I don't even know. You were a fan of the book, weren't you?
Yeah.
Did you see it?
I did not
see it. That's not a good sign.
Yeah, it's not a good sign.
That was like legitimately my favorite book growing up.
It's really not a good sign. Why didn't you see the movie?
Because I covered it so much of it between here and Clever, and just everyone was like, yeah, it's not that great.
Yeah.
And I was like, okay, well, if it's not that great, like, it's been 10 years since I read the book. Like, I'll just wait till it comes out on DVD.
Hmm. And that goes back, I guess, to the second or third questions where Sinead obviously, like, wants to see it because but she's going to wait for Blu-ray. So that can go back to answer your question from before. Yeah, you can go and see a movie if you don't want to spend the money on it. Just wait for it to come out on Blu-ray.
Yeah.
So what do you think, Riley?
I think it really comes down to, I think it was a little bit off on the marketing, and I think it was a bad release date. Mm-hmm. I really do. I think there was way too much competition for this, and it wasn't like an Indiana Jones movie or maybe even a prestige pick from Spielberg that would get a different kind of audience. It checked all the boxes. It was Spielberg, a brand that was beloved, good effects, good actors, all these things. And I just think it was, I think if it was the big friendly giant rather than the BFG, maybe that would have been a little bit, people would have known, oh, okay. But at the same point, you know, I made a tweet where the CGI, I mean, Mark Rylance as the giant freaked me out. Yeah. Like, right. I'm still looking at it going, oh, it just kind of, I don't know, it was a little off. I don't think Spielberg was surrounded by yes men. I think Spielberg knows what he's doing. Mm-hmm. I still think he has his inner circle of people that he talks to and goes, mm-hmm. and that this is a good idea. Great, great book, like you said, Sinead. All the right elements were there.
Right.
I think at the end of the day, bad release date. If you would have put that back in March, maybe
would have done a little better.
Maybe done a little better. Maybe even
November.
November would have been great.
November would have been a good date for that movie.
Yeah, I think it really did. It had all to do with the release date. Yeah. That's what I think.
All right, what's next?
James writes, "Hey, Collider crew, I was perusing Facebook the other day and realized that Daniel Day-Lewis is one Oscar away from making Academy history as the first person to win 4 Oscars for acting, and quite possibly also for acting in a leading role. If he doesn't win for Paul Thomas Anderson's speculated next film, who would you like to see him portray if he aims for another biopic like Lincoln or My Left Foot? Personally, I'd love to see him go full circle and portray George Washington, as we haven't had a major production about his life yet, or have him play Marlon Brando with only a slight resemblance, like what Fassbender did last year with Steve Jobs. I don't know. The idea of one of the greatest actors of all time playing his predecessor intrigues me to no end. Thank you for all you do and keep bringing the filthy."
You know, it's a great question. It's a tough question.
Yeah.
I'm not going to give you a role I think he should play. I will tell you that I think he's definitely going to be the guy that breaks the record. It's just going to happen. Yeah. He's just one of because he's a different kind of animal to where it's like, that dude, he becomes, like, he's never Daniel Day-Lewis.
No.
He becomes the role, and it takes him a while before we see him. It's like, he becomes the role at his house, and that's why he doesn't take as many roles, because he gets so invested in it that his wife is like, yeah, let's hold off on that. I don't really want to live with George Washington for a year.
I will not tell a lie.
Well, so then maybe she says, okay, well, maybe then you should be George Washington. But I think that as far as who he should play, I don't know. There's never going to be a time when you tell me that Daniel Day-Lewis is playing a pig farmer, and I'm going to go, that sucks. Daniel Day-Lewis is playing someone who, you know, works at 7-Eleven. That sucks. Whatever it does, that's great. He's probably the best damn convenience store worker I'd ever see. He'd probably be the best, whatever. He can make everything and anything interesting. I want to see him do anything. I think the guy is great. I just don't know what it is particularly that I can say, that's the one.
Yeah, and we don't have anything on the release schedule right now to know, because he hasn't released.
I'm working at a pet store.
Yeah. I buy that. I'll take that. And I guess I would like to see him. I don't want to see him actually do a role like George Washington or somebody like a biopic, let's say. I would love to see him work with David Fincher or Chris Nolan.
Yeah.
And just give him a meaty part, original, whatever it may be, because you said it right, Christian. He will just show up and just act his pants off, and it'll be amazing as a pet store owner or a pig farmer or whatever. So we can't really call it. I think that he will get this 4th Oscar and make history. We just don't know what. If it is Paul Thomas Anderson with his next movie, you know what? Clear up a side for the ballot for his name, because he'll probably be there.
Yeah, I think so. Is that it?
There's one more.
One more.
Uno mas.
Yep. Matthew writes, "Hey, Collider crew, my question is about directors such as Quentin Tarantino or Kevin Smith, who direct many of the films that they also write. How exactly does this work? Wouldn't the studio be in charge of the script once the rights to it are sold? Or is there something I'm missing here? Thanks."
Yes. What you're missing is, it depends on the director. And it depends on the deal that the director has. As someone, Quentin Tarantino, you know what you're getting when you sign a contract with Quentin Tarantino. And Tarantino's not going to sign that contract without saying he's got final rights on this, and this. He gets to choose whether he does this, or that. And he was able to do that because he built his career to a certain place. Kevin Smith, same thing, where Kevin Smith now is basically making movies for himself and can now do things to where he's getting financing that he's not working with the big studios as much, because Kevin Smith's a guy when you look at Chasing Amy and things like that, they're smaller movies, companies he's working with. It was that kind of relationship that Tarantino had. But then as he started doing bigger movies, he had to kind of go in line and did do studio movies. or you know, the bigger budget kind of big blockbuster movies is where Tarantino still does his Tarantino films.
Yeah.
So it's, you know, someone else I think that we like, they're usually on the smaller scale, like Nicholas Winding Refn. Blomkamp is a guy that is not going to be able to have that as much. And I'm sure that the studio had some say in Elysium and Chappie. I don't know how much say, but I'm assuming they did. But it just depends on the director.
Yeah. And I mean, it is dependent on the director. I think inevitably the studio will get in on that script and give the director notes. They yep. will, again, it's all dependent on the director. I think Tarantino, you're right. They're not going to, especially Tarantino, they're not going to give him notes.
No.
I don't think
no.
they're going to go, yep, you do your thing. Here's money. Go shoot.
Right.
Kevin Smith, not sure. He works with smaller studios, independent. Miramax kind of lets him do his thing
Weinstein.
As well. Weinstein. Sorry, yeah. Weinstein. Yeah. And then, yeah, but I think now Blomkamp probably is getting notes. Maybe that's why he's switching over to Alien, because he has, you know, an idea for it, whatever.
Yeah.
But
well, he's going to be taking notes, right, for Alien, for sure.
Yeah, but, you know, yeah, it's all dependent. But I don't think that there's one, and with Tarantino aside, I don't think there's one studio that wouldn't at least give thoughts on a script written by a director.
Yeah.
They're going to go, hey, you know, if something's not gelling with their marketing campaign or their idea of where the movie should go, there's going to be some notes. But, you know, it also shows that it's a small number of directors and writers that get carte blanche to do what they want. So again, just depends.
All right, that's it. That's our mailbag for today. I'd like to thank everybody joining me today. First, Mark Yody Riley, where can they find you?
You can find me at Riley Around on Twitter and Instagram. Every Tuesday on Collider Nightmares Mailbag, I'm going to pop up. And this past week, there was a big one.
Yeah,
big
go watch
showdown
it.
Went down. We had a good one. It was a barn burner. Why don't you guys go check it out and tell me what you think.
And Sinead DeVries, always nice to have you on Mailbag.
I appreciate it. Yeah, I'm online at Sinead DeVries and at thatsoshinead.com. On Mondays, I'm here hosting Collider TV Talk. On Fridays, hosting Movie Talk. And over the weekends, on Mailbag.
Yeah. Let me just get my plugs. Twitter and Instagram, Christian Harlov. Make sure you check me out, Jedi Council. Like Mark said, make sure you check out the Schmodown every Friday. Catch up on the rankings. We also do a top 10 ranking on the Schmoes Know channel, where it's the top 10 Schmodown competitors that are competing. And we're going to do a complete breakdown after this week's match. Make sure you check that out on Schmoes. Thank you guys very much. Check out Movie Talk tomorrow, and that's where we'll see you.
Hey guys, if you like this video, click the thumbs up button. Also, make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel. It'll help you stay up to date with everything we've got going on here at Collider.